go ahead and get started. I know folks will probably be trickling in, but I do want to start at a reasonable time because I have a lot of content to go over, including some new content I just added while Andrew was presenting the last session. So you're going to get even more stuff than was originally planned for. And this is a session that's particularly important to me for a couple reasons. One, like I said earlier, there's a whole bunch of stuff in here that you're going to learn about that largely only folks inside of Microsoft know about. Even some of the folks in our technology adoption program who are running Exchange 2013 in their production environments don't know some of the things I'm about to tell you. So it's very significant, not just because it's now the third world public presentation on Exchange 2013 in the world, but also because of the nature of the content itself. It's that new, and it's that unknown. So you're literally going to be the first people outside of Microsoft to hear some of this stuff, unless I lose my voice, in which case you'll just read some of it. Okay. Now, as I mentioned earlier, these are normally 60-minute sessions, but quite frankly, it's really difficult to fit all of this content into an hour because we're not just going to be talking about HA and site resilience. We're actually also going to be talking about storage and HA and site resilience. So there's three major categories of information that we're going to go through. Now, as I said, all this stuff's public, and you're going to be the first people to hear some of this stuff. We will probably go long. I hope no more than 15 minutes, so what normally would be a 60-minute session will be a 75-minute session. I completely understand if you can't stay the whole time, so if you have to leave at the end of the hour, that's fine. This will be recorded. You'll still have the slides. You still have my contact info. You can ask me questions later and so forth. But for those of you who can stay, in my opinion, I think it's worth it just because of the significance and the newness of all this stuff. So the agenda is talking about these three areas, but the real agenda is that the story for these three areas is simply much, much better in Exchange 2013. So how many of you are running Exchange 2010 today? Hey, excellent. How many of you are running database availability groups today? Excellent, great. How many of you are struggling with namespaces, certificates, issues around, oh, I can't have a data center failover, et cetera, et cetera? How many of you would actually like a data center failover? The ability of the DAG to just automatically fail over to another data center and keep things up and running. Okay, so in 2010, that's a unicorn. It doesn't exist. In 2013, I brought you a unicorn. We'll get to that. Let's first talk about storage, because storage, as we talked about in the architecture session in the mailbox part, we've done some pretty significant changes with respect to storage. Storage is kind of a catch-all. When we talk about storage, we're talking about the store itself, we're talking about ESE, we're talking about the IOPS, we're talking about the database layout, et cetera, et cetera. And when we think about storage, it's not just referring to the disks on which you're storing the stuff. Now, in the areas of storage, we have four primary new features that we've added. One is this concept of multiple databases per volume. I'll talk about what that means in a minute. The other is this concept of automatic recovery from storage failures. A third one is lag copy enhancements. Now, anybody notice the gap there? There's a fourth one, which I just added, automatic reseed. You're going to be the first people outside of Microsoft to hear about automatic reseed. Even the TAP folks don't know about it because we haven't documented it for them. But it's in the code. If you were to download the preview today, auto reseed is there and it works. And I'm going to describe to you what it is and why it's there. But first, it's important to understand that the majority of the storage changes that we've made, in particular these four changes, they're largely targeted towards environments that don't use RAID. In other words, environments that are using JBOD configurations, just a bunch of disks. And a JBOD configuration is one disk, and on that disk is the database and its log files. That's a JBOD configuration. Almost all the improvements that we made around storage are targeted for JBOD configurations. But all of the changes and all the features that I'm going to describe are supported on any Exchange storage. They're designed for JBOD, but you can use them in SAN environments. You can use them in RAID environments. You can use them in DAS environments. So any storage that you're using today, everything I'm going to talk about, you can use, even if you're not in a JBOD environment. So let's talk about the first one, multiple databases per volume. And this is yet another example of Exchange being forward-looking. Forward-looking and also working hard to ensure that you can use the hardware that you've purchased. Okay, that's what this is about. When you think about where we are, particularly around storage these days, 2 terabyte, 3 terabyte, and 4 terabyte disks, they're out now, people are using them. But soon, there's gonna be 8 terabyte disks, and after that, even larger. And so when you think about something like 2013, you know, given the product name and when it'll be released and what storage will look like after a couple years of its product life cycle and so forth, 8 terabyte drives are coming, and we want to make sure that we are optimized and ready for them today. And that's largely what multiple databases per volume is about. This is what that architecture looks like. You're looking at a database availability group that has 4 servers. And right now I'm showing you 1 disk on each of those servers. And on each server on that 1 disk are 4 databases. And what you don't see with those databases, or of course with each database, is its log stream and its content index that goes with it as well. So when we say multiple databases for volume, this is exactly what we mean. We mean storing multiple databases, either active or passive copies, on the same volume, on the same single disk. Okay, how many of you think you'd be interested in something like that? Sounds scary, huh? But it's not, and you're going to see why it's actually a very cool thing and how it will save you resources and do better for you. So this is what it looks like, and you can see it's a very symmetrical type of deployment. We've got database 1 that's active here, passive here, and we're using a lag copy there. It is not a requirement to use a lag copy. This is just simply one example of how you would do it. And as you can see, we've got DB1 active here, DB2 active here, 3 active here, 4 here, and then the passes and the lag spread across. So that basically, we have these same 4 databases on all 4 servers. It's a very nice symmetric design. And it completely optimizes the use of the hardware in a much more efficient way than you'd be able to do if you stuck with the practice today of a single database per volume. So, 4-member DAG, 4 databases, 4 copies of each database. Very, very nice symmetrical design. 4 databases per volume. Again, very nice symmetry. It's the same group or same set of neighbors on each volume on each server. Again, reinforcing the brick or the building block model we talked about with the architecture. So you also have, what I'm not showing here is the activation preference, but here, by nature of the database copies and the settings for activation preference, you also have a balanced activation preference. So just like you would balance the DAG in Exchange 2010, this is what a balanced DAG could look like in Exchange 2013. And here, the key here is that the number of database copies should always be equal to the number of databases per volume. So in this case, I have 4 copies of each of my databases. That means I want 4 databases on each volume. You want that symmetry there. In fact, it's going to be required for another feature I'm going to talk about in a minute. If you don't have the symmetry, some of the stuff will still work, but you're going to get assertions and other unexpected things. So we are going to have a support requirement for this kind of symmetry if you go down this path. So why would you go down this path? Well, think about it. It's all related to certain elements of the database. First, database sizes have to be manageable. Okay, so in Exchange 2010, as long as you were replicating your database, we recommended that it grew no larger than 2 terabytes. That's fairly manageable. If you weren't replicating, we said 200 gigabytes. But as long as you were replicating in a DAG, we said 2 terabytes. Again, fairly manageable. There may be some operations that are unpleasant with a 2 terabyte database. Reseeding, for example. Any sort of repair or recovery would be very painful for that size database. But it's still a manageable size. We generally don't recommend that you grow your databases beyond 2 terabytes. And that applies to Exchange 2013 as well. Reseeds also have to be fast. Again, if you're in a JBOD environment, every disk failure is a database failure. And every time you replace that disk, you need to reseed it with a new copy of that database. So ideally, you want reseeds to be as fast as possible, and you want them to be as efficient as possible. And that's difficult to do when you're in a model where you've got one database per disk, because you're bound by how fast you can get stuff from the single source. We're source bound in that case. The other factor is that capacity is increasing, but IOPS aren't. How many of you were at my storage presentation last year? Okay, so if you were there last year, you know I talked about why that is. It's the laws of physics. They won't let us get any faster. Okay, here's why. We don't have any materials that we can make disk platters out of that can go faster than 15,000 RPM. It doesn't exist. But even if we could conceive of that material and it did exist, we don't have the power source to go ahead and spin it that fast. So the laws of physics are literally preventing disks from becoming faster. But they are becoming denser. The areal density on disks is increasing substantially. So you're not only getting greater capacity, but you are getting, in some cases, greater throughput, particularly if you're writing sequentially like we do with Exchange. So that's one significant difference. And then, of course, the passive copy. We talked about this in the architecture session. The passive copy has some issues in 2010. First of all, it's equal to the active in terms of IOPS. And because it's a passive copy, that's a very inefficient use of the IOPS. It's one thing to have IOPS for a database that's active because it's servicing clients and doing work, but to have that many IOPS for a passive copy, it's not a good thing. That's why we work so hard to reduce it. The other thing that goes along with that is when you use a lag copy too, another form of a passive copy. Anytime you introduce a lag copy, that's going to have different storage implications. Okay, it's going to have asymmetric storage design. You're going to have X for your non-lag copies and Y for the lag copies. And that can be difficult to track, particularly since databases can move around at a DAG from server to server. And that can make things very difficult from symmetry. And then the last issue is there's really limited agility from low disk space issues in a JBOD environment. About the best that you can do today, and this can be done in 2010 and 2007 as well, if you find yourself running out of space on the volume containing the database, your best bet is to throw away the content index. And that's for a couple reasons. First, the content index is big. It's going to take up a lot of space. So you can throw that away. That's going to slow down search a little bit. Search will still work, but it'll actually have to do the searches live against the store instead of serving it from the index. So you slow down search a little bit, you minimally impair the user experience, but the admins now bought themselves some breathing room. And as a result of that breathing room, they can go ahead and now move mailboxes off or do whatever they need to reclaim the disk space, and then when they're done with that, rebuild the index. It's not the best plan, but it is at least a viable plan in the 2010 days. So how have we solved all these challenges? Well, again, we solved it by going for multiple databases for volume. Now, let me explain how you get the benefits. And this will be confusing for some people because it's a very new and different concept to try to understand. So if you don't get it the first time, it's okay. Don't feel bad. It might take you a little bit to get it. But so think about the notion of having an 8-terabyte disk. Okay, now reconcile that with our best practices maximum database size of 2 terabytes. So if you follow our best practice recommendations and you cap your database at 2 terabytes, you're leaving about 5.5 terabytes of unused disk space. Okay, that's not good. You don't want to do that. So then the tendency would be, well, okay, I want to use that space. I will just grow my databases beyond 2 terabytes. I'll grow them till they fill the disk. Now I'm using all my disk. How efficient is that? Well, that's also not good, too. Because once you grow a database larger and larger than 2 terabytes, now it becomes operationally unmanageable. Things that you would need to do become difficult, if not impossible, to achieve in a normal, reasonable amount of time. So the most common operation we use to talk about this is reseeding. So think about reseeding a 2-terabyte database versus reseeding an 8-terabyte database. I've got the values up here. To do a 2-terabyte database, assuming roughly about 20 megs per second throughput, network's good, the source is good, everything's put through, it's going to be about 23 hours to reseed 2 terabytes worth of data. If I have 8 terabytes, worth of data to reseed in a single database, it's going to take 93 hours. Again, operationally unmanageable. If it takes 93 hours just to reseed that database, it's not going to be a database that you can manage really well. So what's the trade-off? Well, the trade-off is to go for before we talk about the trade-off, also consider what happens when you lose one. So we lose the disk, we have to reseed, we get 20 megs a second, and that's how long it will take. So the solution is multiple databases per disk, capping them at a reasonable size, 2 terabytes, or in the case of an 8-terabyte disk, it'll end up being about 1.5 terabytes per database when you factor in the logs and the content index. So what that means now, to reseed a 2-terabyte disk, that's only going to take about 9.7 hours. And to reseed an 8-terabyte disk, now you're down to only 39 hours. Now, some of you might be scratching your head. I don't understand. How can you? It takes you 93 hours to reseed 8 terabytes when you have one database on there, but now it only takes 39 hours to reseed it when you have 4 databases on there. And the reason for that is, when we're reseeding, we're talking about the difference between reseeding the disk versus reseeding the database. When we talk about reseeding 2 terabytes of data, that's a 2-terabyte database. When we talk about reseeding 8 terabytes of data, that's 4 2-terabyte databases. That's how we get the speed out of it. So the way it works is we've got server 1, DB1's passive, DB2's passive, so is 3, and 4 is active. If we lose server 1, 4 becomes active on another server, and now we have to reseed all the other databases. But because we had copies from other servers on there, namely DB1, DB2, and DB3, and so forth, because the active copy is on different servers, we're seeding from multiple sources. We're no longer effectively source-bound in the seed. And as a result, we get very good throughput, and we can reseed 8 terabytes of data when it's carved into 4 chunks this way, faster than we can reseed 1 chunk of data that's 8 terabytes. Does anybody not get that? So don't feel bad if you don't. Just raise your hand and I'll make sure I explain it again. Oh, that's fantastic. So you can see, obviously, server 3, that has the DB1 active there, so we get the full throughput of 20 megs per second. Same with server 2, another 20 megs per second. But server 4, we're actually seeding 2 different copies at the same time, not just 1 copy. So we're only getting about half of the throughput there, so about 12 megs per second seeding DB3 and DB4. But the aggregate time that it would take to reseed this amount of data when you carve it into these 4 pieces, and 4 is just an example, just happens to be the number of copies I'm using. It could be 3, it could be 5, it could be 6, whatever your environment is. The key here is we're no longer bound by a single source. We're reseeding chunks of data from multiple sources, and as a result, we're able to fill up and reseed an 8-terabyte disk faster than we would had we a single database that was that large. Okay, so that's multiple databases per volume, and you can start to see some of the advantages in terms of reseeds. But there's other advantages as well. For instance, consider this scenario. Again, same 4 servers. Now, in Exchange 2010, we talked about this in the architecture session. Remember, in Exchange 2010, the active copy had the checkpoint depth of 100 meg, and the passive copy had the checkpoint depth of 5 megabytes. And so what that meant is that the IOPS that we needed for the passive copy were equal to the IOPS that were needed for the active copy. So that was really, really inefficient, and we did a lot of work to fix that. So what we did, and I talked about some of how we did it in terms of the IOPS savings, in terms of the raising the checkpoint depth to 100 meg for the passive copy, in terms of rewriting transaction logging for ESE so we could persist the cache on failover, et cetera, et cetera. So we've done a lot of work there already to get that fast failover, even with a high checkpoint depth. Okay, so that work has already been done, and that completely benefits the multiple databases per volume scenario as well. You can see, for example, with just looking at one of the actives on there, that might now be at 40% IOPS utilization. The passes and the lags on the others might just say they're at 30% IOPS utilization of the available one. And even in failure scenarios, you still get a 25% increase in overall aggregate IOPS. Again, because you're supporting multiple databases on the same volume, and because we've reduced IOPS for the passive copy by 50%. So what you end up with is failover speed about twice as fast as what you had in 2010. So by example, in our corporate environment, where we're running 2010 in production, we see failover times of about 20 seconds. In our DF main environment, our dog food environment, where we're running 2013 with these optimizations checked in, we see failover times about 8 to 10 seconds. So significantly faster failovers as a result of moving to this architecture. But at the same time, we not only increase the rate at which we can reseed large chunks of data, but we're also leveraging now these very large disks that we weren't able to leverage before, not because they didn't exist, but because of the capping of the 2 terabyte limit that we recommend to keep your database sizes reasonable. So even when a failure happens, even if I were to lose two of them, where the load on the other servers has now doubled, because of the reduction in IOPS, these servers can still handle the extra load. You're still only at 50% total capacity, even in the worst case, which is what we're showing here, the double failure. All right. Now, some of the other things that we did. We talked about this and how we changed that. We made a couple other changes to make this happen as well. One was, the passive copy, in order to keep up with that low checkpoint depth, it does this very aggressive pre-reading of information. And it does that so that, like I said, it can keep up and provide the fast failover. It's not just enough to have a low checkpoint depth. There's other things we need the passive side to do in order to get that really fast failover, that less than 30-second failover. Now, we don't need that. We don't need it because we've got the larger checkpoint depth, and we persist the cache on that transition from passive to active. And as a result of doing that, the passive copy simply doesn't have to do those pre-reads anymore. So we've detuned it. It no longer does that. And that saves a lot of IOPS on the passive copy. And then there's one other thing that we did. Background database maintenance, which is maintenance that we do to check for corrupt pages and things like that, it's pretty aggressive in Exchange 2010. It runs at about 5 megabytes per second per copy. So you can see it's very aggressive data reading. And again, it's doing that largely because of bad block protection in JBOD environments. We want to know right away, is there a bad page on this disk? Because we will want to go ahead and page patch it and get the database back into a healthy state. And so we're doing a lot of stuff with background database maintenance in 2010 to account for that. But as it turns out, over the last couple of years, we've done a really large amount of analysis inside Office 365, and we've looked at our bad block instance rate inside the service, and we found it's actually quite lower than what we expected. So the rate at which we're seeing bad blocks that translate into jet corruption like negative 1018 or 19 or 21 or 22, any of those, the incidents are actually much, much lower than we really expected. Now, of course, they could vary. They're going to vary based on the quality of the JBOD disk that you're using. But still, you kind of get the idea that the rate of occurrence was much less than we anticipated. So because of that, we actually throttle back background database maintenance. So now it's only running at 1 meg per copy per second. So it's only about 20% of where it was. And again, all these changes that we did, it's less work that the system is doing, translates into less IOPS that the system needs to do its job. So we're using much, much more efficient use of the hardware resources in this. All right. Now, we do have some requirements and best practices. We always want you to use a single logical partition per disk. Okay. So if you're going to store 4 databases on the one disk, you just make one partition and put the 4 databases in separate directories on that disk. You wouldn't create, for example, 4 separate partitions. It's always going to be one logical volume per disk. Next, the database copies has to equal the number of copies per disk. If I've got 4 copies of my database, I must use 4 copies per disk. If I have 3 copies of my database, I must use 3 copies per disk. This will have design implications for you, because some of your databases you might want 2 copies of, some you might want 3 copies of, some you might want 4 copies of. You're going to have to figure out, if you want to go down this route, how many copies you're going to settle on for each database that you have. There is a requirement that that matches. And then from a best practice standpoint, we do recommend that you have the same neighbors on all servers as you saw in the drawing, so 1, 2, 3, and 4 in various positions on the server. balancing not just the load of active and passive copies, but also balancing the activation preference values across the DAG as well. And again, as you saw, there was a lag copy in there. That's not a requirement. You can use non-lag copies, and that will work just fine. And the other best practice is to do that balancing of the activation preferences. That's something you want to do in a DAG anyway, even if you're not going down the route of multiple databases per volume, just so that you have a balanced DAG. Balanced in terms of the number of active copies, balanced in terms of the number of passive copies, and balanced so that the sum total of activation preference for all database copies is largely equal on each DAG member. All right, now I'm about to tell you about a feature that very few people outside this room know about. It's called automatic reseed. So you may have gathered from the multiple databases per volume that one of the other advantages that you get that I didn't directly talk about, obviously, if you're more efficiently using these 8-terabyte disks, then your cost of goods is going down. So there's tremendous cost savings to be had. And of course, it's important to understand that a lot of these new features are being developed based on our experience in the service. So a lot of people are thinking that, well, the cloud's getting all the love, on-premises doesn't get any love. It's actually just the opposite. The cloud does all the hard work and cuts its teeth on all the learnings and scrapes its knuckles and does all the heavy lifting. And then all the lessons it's learned trickle down and become features that benefit on-premise administrators. So when you think about it, it's actually the on-premise administrators that get all the love because they don't have to go through the headache of cutting their teeth on all this stuff. They get the benefit of the learnings from the cloud, and you get to have all the cost savings and efficiencies that we enjoy. So automatic reseed is one of those features. It's born out of the need to take what is normally a lengthy, operator-driven manual process that is well understood and simply have the system executed for us. So automatic reseed. Remember, a disk failure on an active copy equals a database failover. Again, targeted for a JBOD environment. If you're using RAID, that's not true, but in a JBOD environment, every single disk failure is a database failure and a database failover. Also, you have to do something about that right away. In a JBOD environment, if you lose a disk and you lost your database, that may compromise redundancy for you. Maybe you only had two copies and now you've lost one. Now you're down to a single copy. You have no redundancy. You got to do something about that right away. So if you failed a disk, the disk has to be replaced. It has to be initialized and brought online and made viable from the system. Then the administrator has to create the proper structure and do a manual reseed. It's a lot of work. We don't think you necessarily need to do that work. And you want that fast recovery because, again, any failure that you have could be the one that's compromising your redundancy. So it's important to address these as quickly as possible. So the idea behind automatic reseed is that the system will use spare drives that the administrator has pre-installed and pre-configured to automatically replace failed drives and then automatically reseed the database copy that was on those failed drives. Of course, if we're talking about four databases that were lost on a single one, we're talking about automatically reseeding all four copies on that single volume. So, how does it work? Well, we have the in-use storage. This is the storage on which you provisioned your databases and your logs, et cetera, et cetera. And then you provision the system with spares. How many spares? That's up to you. Okay, so just to give you an example of what we do, in Office 365, we generally have about 35, 36 disks in each of the servers, in each of our bricks. And for each server, we have about 3 spares, and we're trying to actually reduce that down to 2. So you don't need a lot of spares. And I point that out because when we talk about replacing failed disks with spare disks, some people mistakenly believe that means you have to have a one-to-one mapping. You have to have a spare for every production disk. No, you just need a small group of spares that can be used by the system. So the way what happens here is if I lose the disk containing the database and I've configured automatic reseed will then go ahead and take one of the spares, put it into the in-use storage pool, will then go ahead and set up the appropriate directory structure, and then from one of the other copies, it will reseed that database. By the way, if you've never seen it, that's what reseeding looks like. Just kidding. And then At that point, the spare's usually no good, so the original disk is no good. We will only invoke automatic reseed under two conditions. Either the disk has disappeared from the operating system's perspective, or we cannot write to that disk. Those are the only two triggers for automatic reseed. So assuming that happens, that means that the original disk is no good, so it doesn't go back into the spare pool. It would be up to the administrator to pull the bad disk and either throw it away or figure out what to do with it after that. But this is effectively how automatic reseed works. And again, it's designed to take an operation that is normally lengthy and manually performed and have the system completely automated for you. Now, there's some technical information you need to know because it's not very straightforward on how to set this up. The way automatic reseed works is it's going to periodically scan for failed and suspended copies. So a copy is going to go into failed and suspended when we can no longer write to the disk. Again, we can't write from a database perspective or the operating system no longer recognizes it. If auto reseed sees a database copy in that condition, it's going to check their prerequisites. First, it's going to make sure there's a spare available and make sure that it's ready for use. Second, it's going to see if we're in a single copy situation, because we might need to take some other steps, maybe alert an administrator that there's a single copy condition that they need to be aware of. But assuming we pass all the prerequisites and so forth, then it will go ahead and allocate and remap one of the spare disks that's in the system. And by remapping, it's basically going to load it under a mount point. I'll talk about the mount point configuration in a moment. Once it has allocated and remapped the spare, it's going to start the seeding process, just like we do a normal reseed. If you were to launch update mailbox database copy, it's the same exact process. After the seeding is done, we verify that the newly seeded copy is healthy. It's back up to date. It's good to go. And then at that point, the original disk is released. And by released, I mean released by auto reseed and by exchange. It's not released back into the spare pool. From our perspective, at that point, it's a dead disk. So it'd be up to the administrator to go ahead and take care of that disk problem, pull it out and put in a new one, and reallocate the new one to a spare when they're done. So the configuration stuff. These are the steps that the administrator would do. And generally, we would largely recommend doing these steps as you're building out your DAG. Yes, you can do them afterwards, but quite frankly, it's somewhat difficult to move the database paths for replicated databases. You have to break replication, you have to move a whole bunch of data around, you have to reestablish replication. It's a pain in the butt. You can do it, it's supported. I wouldn't recommend it, though. It's so much easier just to set this up from the get-go. So you configure your storage subsystem with spare disks. And that's basically nothing more than just having disks there that have been initialized and formatted the same way you'd format them to get them ready to house databases. The only difference is they don't have any data on them. Then you create the DAG, and you add the servers that have this configured storage on it. Nothing revolutionary there. Then you create a directory and mount points. Basically, what we're doing here with automatic reseed is we are leveraging Windows' ability to have multiple mount points being exposed from the same single source. Okay, so it's nothing more magical or complicated than that. It's literally just taking the same place and loading it twice under two different mount points. And I'll show you what those look like in a minute. Then you'll configure the DAG. There's three new properties that you have to configure for automatic reseed. I'll show you what they are in a minute. And then once that's done, you create your mailbox databases and your mailbox database copies, just like you do today in 2010. So how do you configure it? Well, let's look at it. The two primary properties, one is autodag volumes root folder path. The other is autodag databases root folder path. Okay, so let me show you what those look like. So the volume root folder path is simply where the exchange storage lives. This is where all your disks are. All of your disks are going to be loaded under the same single mount point. And you'll give it whatever directory you use. You can see we're using, should actually say C:\exchvols. That would be the directory and mount point that we're using. Similar, C:\exchdbs would be the mount point we're using for the directories containing the databases. So here we've told the DAG two things. Where are the databases and where's the storage? Okay? The volumes is the storage, the databases are the databases. And you can see that yellow line going from the volumes to these three volumes would be the mount points. Now, in this configuration, as this fills up, What I'm showing you here is that on volume one, I've got MDB one, or database one, we'll make it simple. On volume two, MDB two. On volume three, that's my empty spare in this case. And what you can see with these yellow lines is that's showing the relationship between the duplicative use of the mount points. So in other words, MDB one under EXCHDBS is the same as MDB one under EXCHVols. It's the same place, the same folder, if you will. It's just loaded under two different mount points. One for storage, one for databases. Then there's one other property. AutoDAG database copies per volume. And this is where you tell the DAG how many copies you have on each disk. So in the original example I used, that would have been set to 4. Here, in this example, I only have one copy on each volume, MDB1 on volume 1, MDB2 on volume 2. I've got one copy per volume, so I set AutoDAG database copies per volume to 1. Once I've set these three properties using set database availability group, and once I've configured everything beforehand, AutoReceipt is now configured and ready to do its thing. It's that simple. Okay. Any questions on AutoReceipt before I go forward? Just because it's so new and so different, and you're the first people to hear about it, I'm really curious to hear what people think. If anybody has a thought or question they'd like to share. If not, that's cool too. Yes? So that's really a separate issue. Let's take that offline. Okay, well, if you have any comments on automatic reseed, just send them to me offline. I'm really curious to hear what people have to think about this since we haven't gotten feedback from the TAP because they don't know about it yet. So, yes? It can. There's nothing in the DAG configuration that knows anything about the number of spares. So his question was, can the number of spares be changed after you've done the DAG or after you've configured this stuff? Yes, absolutely. The only things that you won't change are these three properties. You know, unless you went ahead and actually went from one copy per volume to three copies or four copies per volume, then you would change that one property. Everything else you would mount under the same existing ones because they all have to be mounted together under the same mount point for AutoReceipt to do its things. But if you add additional spares, or if you decide, you know, we have three spares in there, but at the most I've ever seen is one, so I'm going to pull one out and put that somewhere else and use that disk, and you want to go down to two, that's totally fine. That won't affect this at all. The key, though, is that you're going to have some spare, because if there is no spare, then AutoReceipt will assert, it'll stop working and give you an error message, and then it'd be up to the administrator to not only correct that, but manually fix the problem. So you want to make sure that everything is configured right before you just let it do its thing. Once you have it configured, though, and it does its thing, then it just takes care of it for you. Okay, let's talk about some other recovery behaviors. Automatic recovery from storage failures. This is actually not entirely new behavior. We introduced a lot of this behavior in Exchange 2010. So one of the challenges that we know of is that when you think about a storage controller, today's storage controllers are basically mini PCs, which means they work great, but they can also crash or hang from time to time. Okay, so in Exchange 2010, we came up with behaviors where we let the system detect certain conditions that would prevent the system from moving forward and take, shall we say, more aggressive recovery action than just a database failover. So like, for instance, ESC database hung I.O. If we have I.O. that doesn't return within 240 seconds, which is a very long time to be waiting for I.O., we will go ahead and generate a failure item. What that means is ESC will log an event in an area we call the Crimson Channel inside the event log, and Active Manager is a subscriber to that, and it will pick up that event, and it will go ahead and initiate failover in response to that, or it will restart the server in response to that. Similarly, if we can't write to that Crimson Channel, that's the failure item channel heartbeat, if we can't write to that, that's another reason where we'll try and restart the box. We also periodically send unbuffered I.O. to the system disk just to make sure that is always running as well. And there's another case that if that doesn't come back, or if it hangs, or we have a lost flush, again, we trigger recovery mechanisms. So this is what Exchange 2010 does today, and it's also what Exchange 2013 does as well. But 2013 takes it even farther. By farther, I mean we've added new recovery states as well. So for instance, a system bad state is a new one in 2013. And that is a state in which no threads can be executed at all. Nothing can be scheduled, nothing can be executed, managed code is stopped, everything's dead, the system is basically frozen. Long I.O. times, long for us is about 41 seconds. If we do an I.O. and it doesn't come back after that long, we will go ahead and initiate what we will call in the documentation a forced reboot, but what we called in the Exchange 2010 documentation and what I call up here is a bug check. Basically, we terminate wininit.exe and that causes the box to reboot. Don't freak out about that. If you've never heard of this behavior, if you're wondering why Exchange is causing the server to forcibly crash and restart, we do that because we're exploiting the server's ability to do that. And Exchange did not come up with that technique. That's a technique we borrow from Cluster. That is exactly what Cluster does. If Cluster encounters a hung system disk or some hung state or lengthy I.O. or some other bad problem that normal failover or system restart, service restart cannot correct, Cluster will bug check the box. Okay? And that's a great way because now you have the system having a mechanism to fix what used to be an unrecoverable problem from the system's perspective. Okay? And so that's a good thing. You want the system to be able to do this. Now, not every failure is going to cause the system to be restarted in that fashion. It's only the really hard failures where there is no other option. If it were an administrator, they'd be pushing the power button too. The system is in that bad of a state. So we're just saving them the steps to do that. Exchange takes care of it. When the server goes away, that causes a failover to occur very quickly, and the system stays up and running, and then after the server that's been rebooted comes back up, maybe it's in a better state, maybe not. It's up to the administrator to figure out what to do after that. But now we have, again, new things that we're looking for that can also cause different types of hard recoveries with respect to storage failures. Okay, safety net lag copies. I'm going to go a little quickly through this one because we talked about it in the mailbox section, but I'll talk about some salient points that we didn't talk about in there. So again, remember safety net? We used to call that transport dumpster, but it's doing so much more than transport dumpster. When you think about it, we have a lot of different ways that we have implemented transport high availability. So something like shadow redundancy, keep a copy of the data until all forks are processed. Transport dumpster, keep a copy of the data until we've replicated the logs representing that message to all the passive copies. And the delayed acknowledgement that we do for the sending clients or sending servers. Delay the acknowledgement, don't send that 250 okay until you've persisted the message redundantly somewhere or until you've delivered the message somewhere. So those are pretty reasonable behaviors. And as I mentioned, Office 365 came up with this safety net. Because it's one thing for an on-premises organization to say, yeah, transport dumpster is great, it's getting my messages back, and we're really happy with that. But when you run a world-class service with hundreds of millions of mailboxes, you can't really just get away with okay. You have to take it above and beyond. You have to have mechanisms by which you are guaranteeing redundancy of the messages. Because it would not be a good thing if we were to start losing customer messages in our cloud service. So we have to have mechanisms in place that provide all of these protection mechanisms for those messages and for those customers. And the benefit to you, for those of you who are on-premise administrators, is you get the benefits of these features too. You get to use SafetyNet. So SafetyNet is still in Office 365, but it's moved into Exchange 2013 as well. And it replaces the transport dumpster, which we don't really need anymore because now we have SafetyNet. And because of the way SafetyNet works, we're just going to persist it anyway for X amount of days. We don't have to worry about it being plugged into the replication pipeline. We don't have to worry about doing some form of management with it once the logs have been replicated. We just keep it for X days, and if it's needed, it's there. If it's not needed, it's gone after the administrator defined period. Now, I forget what the default is in Office 365, but on-premises, the default, I believe, is 2 days. You can configure that. You can make it 7 days, 14 days, 21 days, as long as you want to keep those messages persisted in transport, as long as you think you might need to keep that data around. Now, generally, I would imagine that most customers aren't going to go beyond 14 days, because the largest advantage that you get from the safety net behavior and the integration with recovered databases, like lag copies, is the fact that you don't have to do all the heavy work to activate the lag copy. You could have a lag copy up to X amount of days, configure safety net for the same amount of days, and you're covered. It's that simple. And knowing that the maximum amount of days that you can have for a lag copy is 14, then you might not even ever have a safety net that's larger than 14 days of persisted data. You can go that large, but you may not need to. Now, the lag copies, in addition to being integrated with SafetyNet, they also have their own new behaviors as well. They can take care of themselves, so to speak. Now, the actual behaviors disabled by default, and there's different behaviors, and they're enabled differently depending on which behavior you want. So a lag copy has the ability to play itself down when there's a low disk space condition. So it'll replay the logs and get rid of them when they're not needed anymore. That's something that you have to enable in the registry. It's not on by default. There's no commandlet that you can use. It, unfortunately, is a registry modification you need to make. Page patching. We didn't have page patching for lag copies. Obviously, we couldn't because a lag copy is back in time, and it might not even have the bad page to begin with. So how can we page patch something that doesn't exist yet? Well, if you choose to turn it on, and that'll be enabled by default in a page patching condition where we detect page corruption on a lag copy, we will automatically play down that lag copy, bring it up to date, and then send over a good page from another copy. If you don't like that behavior, if you're worried about us destroying the lag nature of your copy in our attempts to repair it, you can turn that behavior off and just be in the old world way of lag copy, where if it does need to be page patched, the administrator has to bring it forward when they're ready. There's also the ability to have automatic playdown when there are less than X number of copies of that database available. The X is configurable. By default, it's 3. And there's also a time window as well. So it's X number of copies for a 24-hour period. So if we see that the lag copy is part of a replicated database set that has fewer than, in this case, 3 copies for 24 hours, that will cause it to automatically play itself up and come up to date and become a healthy passive copy versus a lag copy. That gets enabled in Active Directory. You turn that on through AD, and then the number of copies is configured in the registry. Not the cleanest way to do the configuration of these features, I admit. Kind of unfortunate that it wasn't part of the commandlet set. I hope that's something that we can do post-RTM to make it easier for you. But for now, if you do want to enable these features, you do have to go into the registry or set attributes in AD directly. All right, we talked about the activation with SafetyNet as well. Okay, so believe it or not, that was just the storage stuff. We haven't even talked about the HA stuff and the site resilience stuff yet. That's how much good stuff we have in there for you. So let's get right to the HA stuff. There, we've got a new feature called managed availability. And that's on all servers, not just the mailbox server, not just in a DAG. It's new sets of services that are on all servers. We also have some database failover changes, and that's related to managed availability. Okay, so it's not just database failures and other things that will trigger failover anymore. There's other internal things that can now do it. There's also best copy selection changes, best copy selection being the algorithm that Active Manager uses to figure out what copy to activate when a failover needs to happen or when you're doing a targetless switchover. There's also new maintenance mode. So we have maintenance mode for DAG members in 2010, but now we have maintenance mode for both server roles, not just for DAG members. DAG network auto configuration, single copy alert changes, and some commandlet enhancements as well. Let's talk about each one of these. Now, managed availability is also something that's not really well known outside of Microsoft. The TAPs have a little bit of information on it, but there is no documentation for them yet. It's still in the process of being written. So again, you're going to be hearing things that many people simply don't know about yet. So what is managed availability? Well, remember now, Forgetting about CAS is focusing on mailbox. Remember, everything is happening on mailbox. It's not just the store. It's not just the indexing. It's all the protocols are there now, too. SMTP, HTTP, everything that we used to have, UM, all that stuff are now protocols in the mailbox server. And because the protocols for anybody's mailbox are always serviced by the protocols that are on that server, that means if the protocols go down, access to all of the databases on that server go down with it. Okay, and that's not a good thing. So we have to have a mechanism that's doing more than just tracking issues that affect a database. Because the protocols could completely go away, and the databases might be fine. They're active, they're healthy, they're replicating, but no one can get to them because the protocol stack is down. So we have to do something about that. Now, for most protocols, there's a very quick recovery action simply by restarting it. Restarting IIS, cycling an application pool, those kinds of things. So that will handle most cases. But for those cases where the restart fails, then we'll trigger a failover. Okay? It's that simple. We'll try to fix things up the box. If we can't do that, we'll fail over to a box that we know is healthy. And that's actually an important criteria, that we know is healthy. Because managed availability gives us visibility into the health of all the components on all the servers. Because managed availability is an internal component that runs on every Exchange 2013 server. So, how does it work? I've got up here my client, layer 4 load balancer, a couple CAS, a couple mailbox servers. They say 15, because 15 was the code name, so we're still using the code name. So, what we're going to demonstrate here is there's a timeline of events that's going to occur. And the timeline starts with a user sending a message through OWA. Okay, so I'm on my client there. It goes through CAS, through OWA, and then into the mailbox. Then, after working for a while, there's some failure on OWA. Okay, so you can see over here, OWA just went from yellow to red. OWA has failed now. Now, without managed availability, at this point, an admin would have to step in. Okay, because the database is fine, so the DAG's not going to do any kind of a failover, but the protocol stack's down, so nobody can get to the database. But with managed availability, what will happen is we'll detect that failure, and we'll restart the service. We'll try to bring it back into a healthy state for you. Once the restart is complete, look, OWA just went from red to yellow again, or red to green, depending on the color. Okay, so OWA's working again now. Now, let's say shortly after this restart is completed and life is good, OWA verified is healthy, I can send again. But then, a little bit while later, there's another failure there. But in this case, we detect the failure, we try to restart the service, but let's just pretend this time it didn't restart. We weren't able to bring it into a healthy state. So because the restart failed, this is when managed availability would come in and trigger the database failover from here to here. This is not the DAG doing it. This is managed availability triggering that database failover. And again, OWA service is restarted there. Life is good. We verified it is healthy. And we're now sending messages through the new active database copy. So the whole idea behind here is, yes, stuff breaks, but the experience does not. And that is key, because particularly when you're in a very large, highly scaled service, stuff's breaking all day, every day. Disks are failing, servers are going down, VIPs are dying, load balancers are misconfigured, the top of racks blow up, all sorts of bad things happen. But you want the service to keep running. And so managed availability is there to help you do that. Let's talk a little deeper about it. It is a monitoring framework. Okay, so it's constantly monitoring all aspects of the system, all the protocols, all the components, all the various elements that are doing work. It is monitoring them. And it has individual thresholds and levels that it checks for, all of which are based on configuration items that each individual component team in Exchange created. So it's not like there was one group who came up with all the proper thresholds. Each component team that is responsible for building and shipping a component inside of an Exchange 2013 server was also responsible for adhering to the managed availability framework and providing us with their own code and their own thresholds and their own settings for their component. So if I'm the program manager for Outlook Web App, I not only had to do my Outlook Web App feature, but I also had to do the managed availability aspect of it as well. If I'm a mobility PM, I have to do the managed availability aspect of my mobility component. If I'm a UM PM or a search PM or any of the component teams, they all had to participate. They all had to pay this tax, if you will, to participate in the managed availability framework so that we could have a consistent set of code that worked across not just both the server roles, but across all the components on the server roles as well. Now, it gives you not just a sequencing mechanism of controlling recovery action, but there is escalation and alerting there as well. But there's a significant difference to how you think about that today versus how we used to do it. When you think about the Exchange 2010 paradigm and using something like System Center Operations Manager, that worked, but it didn't work the way we wanted. We were doing a lot of work trying to correlate things inside a correlation engine and trying to put a lot of intelligence into the management pack and into SCOM for it to be able to do its thing and so forth and try to provide root cause analysis and be really intelligent about stuff. But the reality is most of the failures that you get are happening at low levels where you don't get this root cause analysis. So we weren't being as successful as we wanted to be. But with managed availability, everything goes down into that low level. We see it all because, again, it was built by the component teams. So they know what probes to create. They know what parts of OWA we need to periodically test, what parts of POP or SMTP need to be checked and what they need to be checked for and so forth. So that really provides us with some really unique advantages. But we have the escalation factor. And we can escalate through event log mechanisms, which can be received by SCOM and shown in a SCOM UI, in the SCOM portal interface. So you can still use System Center Operations Manager, except that that is going to be your portal where you see what things look like, and it's going to be the escalation mechanism. It's no longer going to be your correlation engine, your knowledge engine, or your recovery mechanism, because now all of that is built into Exchange through managed availability. And then you get, in addition to that, some enhancements to certain areas, namely the best copy selection process I'm going to talk about, and with respect to this new maintenance mode that we've introduced as well, because certain failures can cause a server to be put into a maintenance mode and basically taken out of rotation. So the way it works is we have different actions. I'm going to go through these really quick because you can read them yourselves. But we have actions that will do things like try to restart stuff. We have actions that will try to failover or online and offline stuff. And then if these things fail, if we're simply not able to correct the problem through a restart or a recycle or a failover, at that point, then we would escalate and have a human get involved because it would be beyond the capabilities of the system. But anything that the system can fix, it will try to fix for you. Again, restarting a service, cycling an application work pool, causing a database failover, and so forth. All right, and speaking of database failover changes, when we talk about database failover changes, we're talking about ones that are driven by managed availability. Okay, not the ones that would be driven through the DAG, through Active Manager. All that stuff is still there, and Active Manager is still there doing its thing, looking for database errors, JET errors, and all that other stuff. But errors outside of its realm, again, related to the protocols or to the services stack and so forth, that is within the bailiwick of managed availability. So when managed availability detects some form of failure, that could either be through live data, data that it's collecting in real time, or it could be through synthetic transactions where it is checking the end-to-end user experience. So through either of those means, anytime managed availability detects one of those failures, it has the ability to trigger, by asking Active Manager, to trigger a database failover. Okay, so that is a new behavior change. So you may see things happening in your environment that you didn't expect. There may be some threshold tweaking that you have to do. You may notice that, oh, I'm working with 2013 in a lab, so it doesn't have a lot of resources, but I'm hitting it really, really hard. So it's really resource constrained. I'm moving tons of mailboxes or just overwhelming my lab server, my little VM or whatever I'm doing. When you do something like that, you're going to see these behaviors firsthand. You're going to see that the system is detected, things are under stress, and it's going to start doing things like restarting services for you or triggering failovers and so forth. So you want to be aware of these behaviors and how they operate. Now, at RTM, I don't want to promise, but I'm pretty sure I'll get to it. At RTM, I do expect to have documented all of the things that you need to worry about. So all the probes, all the monitors, all the thresholds, how to configure them, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So you'll be able to tune things specifically for your environments based on your resource usage. So if you run kind of lean, you know, you've over-provisioned your servers, you're going to want to throttle things back. If you've under-provisioned your servers, you may need to ratchet things up and so forth. So we'll have that documented for you, again, hopefully by RTM, if not by GA. And no, I'm not telling you when either of those dates are. Okay, now the failovers come in two forms. If it's a protocol failure, that's going to trigger a server failover because, again, all the databases are served by the protocols on that server. So if the protocols are down, it doesn't matter how healthy the databases are, nothing's getting through to them. So we have to trigger a server failover for that. Now, for the database failover, that's a store detected kind of thing. So if there's a problem that the store detects, or JET, or ESE, or the underlying storage subsystem, that would be just an individual database failover. We wouldn't have to do anything with the whole entire server, unless it were a hung system disk, in which case the bug check will cause the server failover. And then we also throttle these managed availability database failovers. We throttle them in time, and we throttle them across the DAG as well. So that means if there's a cascading sequence of failures, or if it means as a result of a failure, now there's a greater than anticipated load on another server, we don't mistakenly trigger another one. Okay, so we'll throttle them around so we don't just, you know, move back and forth or everywhere we think there's better resources. Everything is very well managed and very well controlled. And again, it's largely based on either bad stuff as a result of live data that's collected or as a result of the synthetic transactions that we do. But the new architecture that we have to be smarter about it. Remember, Exchange 2010 didn't really care about the protocol health. All it was concerned is what's the best database copy to activate. But that's not good enough for Exchange 2013 because, again, the protocols are always serviced from the server hosting the database. So it doesn't necessarily matter that you have a healthy database. You have to have healthy protocols as well. Okay, so that's a big distinction. Now, there's three new criteria that we use, and I'll actually talk about them in the BCS selection, so I'm not going to talk about them in here. But just be aware, though, the criteria we use for selecting the best copy to activate is very different from what we did in 2010. We still do some of the same steps in terms of the 10 sets of criteria and whatnot, but there's a lot more things that we're doing. The idea is that whenever we fail over a database to another server, our one rule is that we do not make things worse. So that means it's not just enough to look at the health of the database. We also have to look at the health of the protocols themselves. So if we have a protocol that fails on server A, we have to check the protocols on all the other servers that have copy of the databases to make sure that they're in a better state than the failed one. In other words, something operational. If we don't have that, it's not going to be part of our selection criteria. We can make the situation no worse when we fail over. We always have to fail over to a better state. So let's talk about those BCS changes. So how many of you are familiar with best copy selection in the first place? Is there anybody who doesn't know what it is? Raise your hand. Okay. So best copy selection, this is an algorithm that lives inside Active Manager. And it's the algorithm that when you have a failure affecting the active copy of a database, or the administrator just wants to do a switchover, but they're not saying what server to move to, we call that a targetless switchover, then in both those cases, it's up to the system to determine which copy to activate. And the system evaluates certain criteria, and based on the criteria and the health and status of the copies, that's how it generates its best copy selection algorithm. Okay, so that's basically what that process is. That's still there. The inputs would be a list of all the passive copies, and then some state information, the copy queue length, the replay queue length, the content index status, and the database status. So with Exchange 2010, we had that criteria. And as I mentioned before, that's not good enough for 2013 because we're not considering the protocols. We have to consider the protocols in 2013 because without them, they're on the same box. Without them, we have no access to the database. So there's some new constraints that we force on the BCS process. And in fact, because of these constraints, because of the different ways that we do it, we don't call it BCS anymore. We call it BCSS, best copy and server selection. It's not just about choosing the best database copy anymore. It's also about choosing the best server and the best copy. So what's the same? Again, it's still Active Manager. It's just new logic we gave Active Manager. It still performed its star over time, so a failover or a targetless switchover based on the health of the system at that time. It's still, the replication is still determined by those same 10 criteria if you've seen the 2010 sessions or if you've read the TechNet documentation that covers Active Manager, you know that there's 10 sets of criteria we look at as we pass through this list of databases. So we still use all that same stuff. But we've added other stuff. So for instance, we cap the size of the replay queue length. Okay, we don't want just something unbounded because we want to be able to reasonably activate in a decent amount of time. So we do put a cap on that. We also, as I mentioned, include the health of the entire protocol stack, particularly with respect to the specific failure. If OWA failed on a server, we have to make sure that OWA is healthy on the servers that we're failing over to. Okay, again, we're making things no worse. And then there's the prioritized protocol health set. So when we talk about managed availability and we talk about these probes and these monitors, when you group them together, we group them into what we call health sets. And that gives us the overall larger big picture view of the overall health of the server. So when you think about the OWA health set, it's doing things like OWA logon, OWA rendering, OWA retrieving, OWA viewing, OWA sorting, and so forth. And all of those different probes make up what we would call the OWA health set. So these health sets all have a priority assigned to them. Obviously, some health sets are going to be higher priority than other health sets. For instance, and this may not be the case in all organizations, but in many organizations, arguably, HTTPS is a higher priority protocol from an exchange perspective than, say, for instance, IMAP. Again, it's not a hard and fast rule. There's some customers who are IMAP only, and that's fine. But for most customers, a lot of them are using the more modern clients with HTTP, and so, for instance, they would consider OWA to be a higher priority protocol than something like IMAP. They might consider, you know, Exchange Active Sync to be higher priority than POP, for instance. Okay, so each of these health sets has a priority, and we factor in that priority when we're evaluating the health set as well. It's not just the overall health set, but which one takes priority. And we need to do that because if the failure is at a baser level underneath the protocol, we need to at least ensure that the highest priority protocol is taken care of and can be activated, again, making things no worse. And then we've got some the replication health thresholds that we've tweaked a bit as well. So we do allow things to be a little bit more flexible in terms of replication health, but that's largely to account for variances in the two systems. So what does it look like? There's four new basic Active Manager checks. We will still go through checking each of those 10 phases of criteria like we did in 2010, but we've added four new checks. And I'm going to show you the four new checks in the order in which they're done. So the first check is all healthy. And basically what that means is there a server that hosts a copy of these databases that's all healthy? Okay, everything's good on that server. We know it's a great place to go to. If we don't find a server that's like that, then up to normal healthy. Okay, so that means all protocols that have a medium priority are, or medium and above are in a healthy state. Okay, so that would be medium, high, and critical priority. The four priorities. Next is all better than the source. Again, it goes to what's the nature of the failure on the source. If it was OWA, we want to make sure OWA is healthier on the target we're activating. If it was Active Sync, we need to make sure Active Sync is healthy on the target we're activating. If it was IIS, we have to make sure IIS is healthier on the target we're activating, and so forth. And then the last one is same as source. which, depending on the nature of the failure, may or may not be a better condition for you. It won't be worse, but it might not be a better condition for you. Generally, it should be, unless you're having some sort of cascading failure that's going from server to server to server. Generally, you're going to have servers that are going to be in a much better state than the ones that have failed. And so it's going to be very rare where we get down to the same as the source, where the health sets are all in the same states. And again, you may not like that condition, because the whole premise behind this is that some failures occurred. And so if the other server's in that same health state, then things could be just as bad over there. But it's okay if they're equivalent. It's not okay if they're worse. So we will never fail over and make things worse. Okay, let me talk about maintenance mode. So maintenance mode, that's new functionality that we've extended to Mailbox and CAS so that you can put them in and out of service. Okay, and it's a way for an administrator to say that I'm doing something with this server. It's not ready for production purposes. And that's not just a way to like flag it so that other people don't do things, or that you can run a command and see that it's in maintenance mode. It's so that the other components know what's going on, so that the internal mechanisms are aware that this service is in maintenance. So as an example, you put a CAS server into maintenance mode. What that means is it will stop responding to the pings coming from the load balancer. Now, what that response will actually end up being, we're still working on that. I mentioned earlier that we're working with load balancer vendors to help them understand the nature of that communications and how to react that way. So that is the plan of record for what we're doing there. In the case of Mailbox, it might be something where you've just deployed a Mailbox server, or you're updating the Mailbox server with a service pack or some Windows updates or whatnot, and so you want to take that server out of production, you put it into maintenance mode, then you can do all your work, and none of the BCS or any of the algorithms or any other components are going to want to use that server for anything. So it's basically commands that you can use to say, this thing's in maintenance mode, consider it offline, don't send any client traffic or any load over to it. So when you put a server into maintenance mode, if it happens to be a DAG member, it's going to do a server switchover, just like we would start DAG server maintenance in 2010. And it's going to move the active copies, and it's going to block them from coming back. So that's one protection for you. It's going to you'll run the set server component state. That's the commandlet that you use to put something in and out of service for, again, CAS and Mailbox. Out of service from a Mailbox, that means two things. For a Mailbox server to be out of service, that means no active databases, and Hub Transport, or the transport service, is offline. For CAS, that means it's no longer responding to that per protocol NLB health check. Okay, and again, that plumbing will be there. It's not entirely there now. We're still working with the load balancing vendors, but that is the plan to help them understand the response that we're going to give back when we're in maintenance mode versus server gone away. All right, and there's also separate tracking as well. When you have a system in maintenance mode, it can be for things like, it can be put into maintenance mode because managed availability found something wrong with it and needed to put it into maintenance mode to take it out of production. It can be sidelined by an operator. The operator just happens to notice something is wrong and they need to fix the server, so the operator manually runs the commandlet and puts it into maintenance mode. By the way, when we talk about operator is the term we use for an administrator in the service. Okay, so operator, administrator, same thing. Functional, again, that might be something where I'm deploying the server. I'm running setup, and it's actually doing its thing. MA will go ahead and stamp that as offline from a functional perspective because it's not yet fully configured and not ready for service. And once it is, or actually that's during setup running, and then once setup is finished but it's still being configured, then it's marked for deployment and taken out of service that way. Okay, let's talk about some DAG network enhancements. These will be pretty quick because they're very simple to understand. So in a DAG, you have now a choice. You get automatic or manual DAG configuration. The default is automatic. If you don't want the DAG to automatically manage your DAG networks for you, you have to turn that off. You can check a box in the GUI or use a commandlet to go ahead and turn that off. The default is on, and by on, what's going to happen is first, when you add servers to the DAG, it's automatically going to enumerate the networks and create the proper replication and mapping networks for you, just like we did in Exchange 2010. Yay. But if you happen to be in a multi-subnet environment, it's going to go one step further and collapse your DAG networks for you. You no longer have to collapse DAG networks in an Exchange 2013 environment. If you want to do that still, you can. Turn it to manual config and have at it. But if you don't want to do it, and most people don't because it's kind of a pain and a lot of administrators forget to do it, now the DAG can do it for you with its automatic network configuration. So the default is automatic. So the DAG is self-managing from a network perspective. You still have to have the configuration settings right, though. You still have to configure the replication network differently from the mapping network, in particular with respect to the DNS settings and the default gateway. The replication network will never have a default gateway. It's a non-routable network. The replication network will never be registered to DNS. We don't want it in there. There's no point for it to be there. But the mapping network will have a default gateway. It will be routable, and it will be registered in DNS. And those are the configuration differences that the system will use to determine which card you wanted to be the mapping network and which one you wanted to be the replication network. And then, as I said, after that, it will go ahead and do the collapsing for you, too. So you don't have to do anything. You can just install the servers, and everything just happens automatically. If you want to, you can set it up for manual. And in fact, if you want to use the Exchange Administration Center to view network configuration settings, you have to set it to manual. Otherwise, you'll have to use the commandlet to pipe out the information. So let me show you what that looks like. So if you haven't seen it, this is the Exchange Administration Center. And you're looking at a database availability group here. Let me get my mouse up. So here, if I click edit on this, we can bring up the DAG page. And here's that checkbox that says configure database availability group networks manually. So you can see that it's unchecked by default. So again, the default is automatic configuration. I can go ahead and check that here and save that. I actually don't need to click. These are just pictures. And now you can see, actually, let me go back and show you one of the differences here. If you look, let me see if my laser works. Oh, my laser's dead. OK, if you look up here, you can see the DAG networks are listed under DAG network. It's very tiny. It says MAPI DAG network and replication DAG network 01. Okay, that's all you see with automatic configuration, that there are two networks. You can't see anything about them. So again, you edit the DAG, you find this box here, you check it, you click save, and then now look. Now you've got these other options under here. You've got things like disable replication, remove, and view details. So I can go ahead and let's look at the mapping network. I'll just click view details here. And now you can see what the mapping network looks like. We give it the default name, MAPI DAG network. Instead of just DAG network 01, 02, 03, now we're smart. The MAPI one we'll call MAPI DAG network. And then the others will be replication DAG network 1, replication DAG network 2, and so forth. And you've got all the same configuration options you had in 2010. Can configure the subnets, give it an optional description, enable or disable replication, same stuff. But the difference is in 2010, you had full writable configuration access to this by default. In 2013, you don't. You have to do what I just did in order to get in here. So if we cancel out of this and we look at the replication one, you can see it's pretty much the same information there. All right. So just be aware that the default is for the DAG to configure things for you. All right, let's talk about the single copy alert. How many of you are familiar with that? Oh, really? How many of you are running Exchange 2010 with a DAG? Okay. Have a look at your task scheduler, because in there you will see a scheduled task that was installed by the Exchange Mailbox server role called Database 1 Copy Alert. Okay? It's what we call our single copy alert. It's a script that runs on a scheduled basis, and it looks for situations in which a replicated copy is down to one healthy copy. And when it finds that situation, it notifies an administrator, because that is the worst possible situation to be in, particularly when you're running in a JBOD environment, where if that last disk fails, it's taking out your last database with you as well. So the single copy was super important. It was so important, we actually originally released the script out of band in between Exchange 2010, RTM, and SP1. Then we took it one step further in SP2, and we eliminated your need to install it manually. Okay? We went ahead and set it up for you in SP2, gave it the database one copy alert name and task scheduler, and it's just running on your mailbox server right now and waiting to do things if it runs into a single copy condition. So that script was not the most efficient way to do things, and we didn't like having the external dependency of the task scheduler on it. So the single copy alert has been changed. It's now run natively as part of managed availability. It's no longer a scheduled script. So you won't see anything in task scheduler on Exchange 2013. Inside, managed availability will be periodically checking for this condition. And if this condition exists, it will largely exhibit the same behaviors we had in Exchange 2010. So for instance, let me go a little further, we'll log the red alert or the green alert events. So if we have a single copy condition, we'll log 4113. Once we come out of that condition, we'll log 4114 and say everything's all green. Okay, so that's a big difference. The other difference is the single copy alert used to be per database, but now it's per server. Because per database, it didn't really work out that well, because you could have you could be down to a single copy problem all on the same server with multiple databases, and then you end up getting like 10 or 15 alerts just for that one server. And that's not a very efficient thing. So now we've actually done the alert per server. So if you're down to a single copy for multiple databases on that server, we just alert you for that server. We don't spam you with a million one. It's still triggered across all machines with copies, but you'll only get one per server now instead of just being flooded with them. And again, the monitoring's through the notification in the Crimson channel, the 4113 or the 4114. So the behaviors have largely not changed. It's just that it's not an external script being executed by task scheduler anymore. It's built-in native managed availability functionality right now. All right, some commandlet enhancements. I'm actually going to go through these pretty quickly as well, because you can read a lot of them, and I want to get to the next section. Which is site resilience, but we do have some new things like setdag, for example. You can see the three properties for automatic reseed are in there. Manual DAG network configuration, that's what you set to true or false to turn on the automatic DAG network configuration. Replay lag manager enabled, that is how you enable the automatic play down for lagged copies for page patching. The others, again, have to be enabled in the registry. This is how you enable it for page patching. Restore DAG has a new parameter with it as well. Use primary witness server. Okay, so when you're running restore DAG, if your primary witness server happens to be okay, then you don't need to use an alternate witness server anymore. You can point it at the primary. Set mailbox database has auto DAG exclude from monitoring. That's how you would take a server offline from a managed availability perspective and have MA stop doing its thing with that server. And the rest are, you know, corner case stuff. It's good to have and good to know, but most customers won't use a lot of those, but they're in there and you can read the documentation as to how they're used. The last thing I want to talk about is the site resilience aspect, because that has changed significantly in Exchange 2013, and this is the unicorn that I brought you. How many of you have your DAG extended to multiple AD sites? Right. How many of you would like to, but you haven't because it's too difficult? Oh, only two people. Cool. Okay. Well, things got a whole lot easier for you in Exchange 2013. Whether you're doing it now or you want to do it, things are so much better. It's operationally simplified. By that, I mean that when you think about a disaster that affects an entire data center, almost all of the time is spent restoring service. From the recovery aspect. What we're talking about here is doing away with all that time and giving you the automatic failover that customers have asked for with Exchange 2010. The other significant change we made is that the recovery of mailbox and CAS are no longer tied together. One of the reasons you can't get database failover in Exchange 2010 is because we're only talking about the DAG. You still have to deal with the namespace. When you think about Exchange 2010, the namespace is largely the biggest single point of failure you have in the system. Because that's where it tells the users to go. And if that changes, that is very difficult to change. Sure, you can change DNS, but now you have to deal with DNS replication latency, you have to deal with DNS TTL, you have to deal with convergence issues, which here in New Zealand aren't bad, but in many other parts of the world are horrible. You also have to deal with the plethora of clients and DNS clients that you have to deal with and all the name resolution. And it's kind of a pain to have to do that. They are forever coupled, just as the server roles are tightly coupled in 2010. In 2013, that is not the case. Recovery is completely independent. You could recover the DAG separately from recovering your front end or separately from recovering your CAS. The namespace is the key, though. It's the namespace providing redundancy. Now, when we talked about this in the client access architecture session, part one, we were largely focused on that GeoDNS and the round robin, and that's largely what we're doing here as well. We're leveraging the client's ability to accept and leverage multiple IP addresses. Okay? And you're going to see a significant difference here in terms of the behavior. Any hard failures, clients simply skip over them. They wait 20 seconds, nothing happens, they try the next one. Keep that 20-second figure in mind. It's going to be significant later. So, whoops, I'm going the wrong way. Oh, okay, so operationally simplified. So previously, if you lost a CAS server, or if you lose your CAS array, or the VIP, or the load balancer, or the top of rack, or some portion of the DAG where you've lost a majority of services, that required the admin to perform a data center switchover, a manual activation of the messaging system in the other data center that involved activating the DAG and activating the non-mailbox roles, CAS, Hub, and UM. In Exchange 2013, recovery happens automatically. We don't need the administrator to do these things. Now, you can devise a design and an architecture where you still have to do these, but you can also design an architecture where you don't have to do this anymore. And the admin focuses on fixing the issue instead of restoring service. And any administrator will tell you that the stress involved with restoring service is so much greater than the stress involved with fixing an issue. Which is harder for you? Replacing a failed load balancer or having the CEO in your ear going, when's email going to be up again? It's a totally different level of stress. And so we've taken that stress away. The admin no longer needs to perform that recovery manually anymore. The system can do it automatically, and the admin is now free to simply fix the problem that happened in the first place. Load balancer failed, fix the load balancer. Service is already up and running. The admin doesn't have to worry about that. Mailbox and CAS recovery are now independent. They're no longer tied together. Previously, they were. You couldn't just move the DAG over there. You had to have a namespace. And your choice was either let users use the same namespace they were used to using or give them a second one, which made things even worse because it can be confusing. And they may not remember it, and they may try to go to the old one. But they were tied together. You couldn't just put the DAG over there. Sure, we can do redirection of proxy across sites in 2010, but you don't want to do that, especially if you have a partial data center outage. Now, in 2013, recovery is independent and can be in the form of automatic recovery if you configure it that way. So, what's the last aspect? The namespace, and this is the key. The namespace providing the redundancy. Put slightly different, we now put it on the client to provide redundancy through multiple IP addresses. So DNS resolved to multiple IP addresses. Almost all protocol access in Exchange 2013 is HTTP-based. And conveniently, every single modern HTTP client on the planet supports the ability to get multiple DNS IP addresses and supports the ability to round robin across them. Doesn't matter what OS you're using, doesn't matter what browser you're using. It's redundancy built into the HTTP client itself. Any hard failures, clients simply skip over them. Again, there'd be a 20-second wait, they'll try that address, no response, 20 seconds later, they'll try the next one. Again, hang on to that 20 seconds. Admins have control over it, too. If an admin wants to do a switchover, they simply remove one of the virtual IPs from DNS, and that will eventually stop getting handed out by the DNS server, and all traffic will move away from that server. It's a very, very simple way of doing a switchover. This means the namespace is no longer a single point of failure, because you've got redundancy built in into the namespace, into the DNS resolution process. And it also means you don't have to deal with DNS latency, because you're not changing the IP address for a DNS record. You're sending multiple IP addresses out already for that DNS record. We didn't do that in Exchange 2010. We weren't exploiting that. We didn't have that architecture. We do now, and we are using it. So if I lose the load balancer in my primary, failover to another VIP is going to happen automatically. The admin deals with replacing the failed equipment and not restoring service. The system restores service for you. Much, much less stress on the admin. Much less stress. No DNS latency. What that means is the impact with a failover to the secondary. Remember when we had that hard failure? How long does failover take? Who knows? Raise your hand. You. Yes, that's right. 20 seconds. And it's automatic. Yes, data center failover. The unicorn has arrived. And in some failure scenarios, you get a reduced RTO as well. Because 20 seconds, that's significantly reduced. It might take you 45 minutes just to find the person to make the decision to do the switchover versus having it happen automatically and having a 20-second delay. And 20 seconds, remember, that's the client retry time. So from the user experience, they don't see any of this stuff happening. They just see their client open and functioning. And so they really don't have any impact to it at all. They may not even notice that the infrastructure is now being served from a different data center. They would if you had to do a data center switchover, but they won't in a data center failover scenario. So, what does this look like? Well, let's first look at the CAS aspect of it. So, I've got the CAS array here. And again, not an RPC CAS array, just the CAS array in 2013. And I've got a CAS array over here, and I've got the virtual IPs for my load balancers in front of them, the 192.168 and the 10.0.0. And I've got two data centers, Redmond and Portland, a little firewall in between them. So, what happens is, with multiple VIP endpoints, if one fails, they just fail over to the alternate one, and it just works. Okay, the client doesn't have to do anything. It already has the second address, so once the first one fails, 20 seconds later, try the second one. Now, assuming the second one's up and running, which it should be, life is good. They've just automatically failed over through CAS. Now, if the administrator wants to do some work, they can actually remove the failing IP from DNS, which means it stops getting handed out. Okay, so that'll eventually swing all traffic over to the other side. And when they're ready to put it back in service, they just re-add it into DNS. The DNS server starts handing it out again, and eventually traffic will start moving back. And what will actually happen is traffic is going to just end up load balancing across both of them. Now, let's look at what happens on the mailbox server site. So this is a DAG. It's a four-member DAG extended to two sites. I've considered Redmond to be my primary site, so that's where I put my witness server. This experience with two data centers in Exchange 2013 in the DAG is exactly the same experience you get today with 2010. If I lose that, I've lost quorum on this side. I have to do a data center switchover. I follow these few steps. It's much, much quicker. There were seven steps you had to do in 2010. There's only three you need to do for the DAG in 2013. Once I've done that, then I've got the DAG back up and running. That's the two data center approach. Now, here's another unicorn. Three sites. What we told you not to do with 2010, we're telling you to do with 2013. People wanted this. We worked very hard to make this happen. We also wanted this for the service as well. And in fact, we specifically have our witness already separate in the service. So we have our DAGs largely extended across multiple continents. So for example, Europe and North America. And we always have our witness server on another continent for resiliency purposes, geo-resiliency purposes. So with the namespace simplification, the consolidation of server roles, separation of CAS array and DAG recovery, the decoupling of CAS and mailbox by AD site, where you don't need to have CAS and mailbox in every AD site, and the load balancing changes going from layer 7 to layer 4 and having all the session be on that one island server. As a result of that, if you have three locations and you architect it right, you can get data center failovers for your DAG. Here's what that looks like. You have to have three locations, two of which are going to be for Exchange, one of which is going to be for the witness. Okay? Exchange sites have to be well connected. We're still talking about a DAG. We're still talking about the fact that you have to have reliable networking. The DAG was not designed to overcome unreliable or flaky networking, so you have to have well-connected sites. The witness server site does not need to be well-connected. Maybe a branch office that you have somewhere out there. Just some place where you can have a server machine be in a secure location. So when we talk about a small branch office somewhere, we're not talking about, you know, some desktop sitting on some secretary's desk somewhere that anybody can come up and do anything to. We're still talking about a server in a third location. And it has to be isolated from network of failures affecting the other two sites. Obviously, because if you sever networking across multiple sites, this can't do anything for you. Okay? So these are the requirements that you have to have. And then it looks something like this. Same DAG, same four members, same two data centers, but now I've got a third data center in Paris, France, different continent. Doesn't have to be a different continent. We just like doing that for resiliency in Office 365. So now what happens? If I lose that, they can still talk to the witness. They stay up and running. You now have a data center failover for your DAG at this point, because all we care about is the DAG. CAS is independent and separate from this. We don't know what the nature of the failure is. Maybe it's the whole data center, and maybe CAS will be failing over through the namespace redundancy as well, but now it's not something that the administrator has to work on. It's not something where the admin has to go in and change DNS and deal with DNS latency. It's not something where the administrator has to execute a bunch of commands in order to recover the DAG. You can just have the DAG automatically fail over now as long as you have the proper configuration, and it'll keep running, even if CAS still is running in the primary data center. Everything is separate now. Everything is isolated and independent. So assuming 3 and 4 are operational and one of them can lock the witness.log file, you get automatic failover for your DAG. And then if not, if there's some other problem, or as I said before, if you don't go three sites, if you only have two sites, you still have all that fast recovery that you can do very quickly using the previous steps. You don't have to do all those other steps, in part because, again, CAS is completely separate, the namespace is completely aside from the DAG, and all the other server roles don't exist anymore. So there's no non-mailbox server role that you'd have to recover like Hub and UM in the 2010 paradigm. It's a huge, huge difference now. All right. It's a lot of stuff, I know. But don't worry, it's recorded. You'll get the slide deck. You'll see the documentation in TechNet. You can download the preview and try this stuff out. Also, when you download the slide decks, there's a lot of notes that I put in there as well. So you'll see some other information that will give you some more background and more historical information as well. So hopefully now that you've seen that the story around storage, high availability, and site resilience is much, much better in Exchange 2013. The recoveries and the behaviors that folks have asked for from the data center perspective in Exchange 2010 are now here and available for you. The ability of us to have redundancy built in the namespace, that's now here and available for you. And you don't have to upgrade your clients. It works, like I said, with all modern HTTP clients. And again, your difference now, when we talk about data center failovers from the client access perspective, you're talking difference of whatever your RTO was in Exchange 2010 to now 20 seconds in Exchange 2013. All right. And with that, I'm going to open it up to questions, and then we'll do some giveaways. Yes? Wait. Yes, I tell them not to, yeah. I presented before, but thanks. I can say that to him, it's okay. Yes. Yes. How are you managing them now? Right. So you would do the same thing you're doing in 2010, which would be to use split DNS, so that you've got the same names. You only hand out the one name to your users, and depending on what DNS server they hit, it'll resolve either internally or externally. So a split DNS is absolutely the way to go. Just like it was in 2010, to control that traffic flow, you want to do the same thing in 2013. Yes? Yes? No. It's still up to... So the question was, with automatic reseed, it looks like management of the disks is now being done by Exchange versus the OS. No, the administrator has to set up the storage manually. And so they'll do that using the OS. They'll set up the mount points, they'll set up, you know, the storage, they'll do the formatting and stuff. All we do is look to the mount points that you've told us, and then we look for disks in those mount points that don't have any data on it, and that's how we recognize which ones are spares. No. So there's multiple mount points for each one that you'll use. So one of the mount points points to the collection of storage. That's the volumes root folder path. So you take all of your individual storage and you load them under the same one mount point. Say, for instance, C:\EX volumes. Okay, so that's how you've told Exchange where the storage is. Then on that same disk, you put your databases in separate directories, and then you create new mount points for the databases. So C:\EXCH databases, if you will. They're both pointed the same one place, but the difference is how Exchange uses them. The volume ones it's going to use to figure out where there's empty storage. It'll look under that mount point, find a volume that doesn't have anything on it, and that will be its empty storage. When it needs to know where the databases are, it will look under the other mount point, under the other directory, and start enumerating the databases there for work it needs to do there. And then there's the last setting, which is the number of copies per volume as well. Yes? Deduplication? We don't have any deduplication in Exchange 2013. It was never in, so I guess, yeah, it's staying out. I'll say that, sure. It's not in, so it must be out. Okay, yes? So the question is, if I'm using multiple IP addresses and I'm moving around, is it going to cause the clients to re-authenticate? No, it should not, because all that is held in the session, and the session is staying on the mailbox server. Yes? What about when you put TMG in front of it? I'm going to decline to answer that. Do we talk about... I'm going to decline to answer that. Not to be cryptic or a jerk or anything, I just know what I'm not supposed to talk about and what I'm supposed to talk about. So, okay, Andrew. We have not talked about pinpoint DNS zones yet, and I don't know that that will make it into... Well, we'll see. We'll see. That hasn't signed off yet. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, that's right. Dedupe does require I/O. Yes. 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 That's a good trick. Yes. Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, there's nothing to stop you from doing that, except that you don't get the same behaviors with 2010 because the namespace doesn't go with it. So remember, yes, that's right. It doesn't matter that you can get automatic failover for the DAG. You have the CAS and the namespace recovery and hub, for that matter, that go along with it. So you could construct a mechanism that would do that for you, but that will, in the 2010 paradigm, that will only increase your both your cost of goods and it will increase your complexity. And let me also just, you bring up an interesting point that I should clarify. I don't want you to think that we're telling people to go out and get three data centers, okay? Because that's not what we're saying. But what we are saying is if you do have three locations, now you have new options available to you. So I'm not saying that this is so great, go buy some property on some other continent and make that your new server room. That's not what I'm saying at all. We don't want you to increase your cost of goods. The whole point of exchange is to lower your costs. So if you have the ability with multiple sites, at least two of which are well-connected for the exchange purposes, and then one of which, again, could be a less well-connected branch office, then you now have the opportunity to deploy in this other configuration. The irony is amazing, though, when you think about it. With Exchange 2010, the third data center made things so much more complex, you had to have greater operational maturity just to manage it, even though you didn't get the data center failover. With 2013, now when you think about it, the opposite is true. Because we have the built-in recovery mechanism that can do this for you, now arguably you need less operational maturity to have the witness in a third location because the system is now decoupled and designed to handle that and to provide you recovery for the back end in that case. So, for me, it's just it's almost beautiful irony to look at that situation and see you couldn't do it here, and if you tried, you had to be super sophisticated, and now we're saying, yes, you can do it here, and, you know, a monkey could do it. Well, not technically a monkey, but maybe a higher life form. Yes. Yes, so we've broken the namespace part. Well, I shouldn't say broken, we've decoupled it. We've decoupled CAS and mailbox from each other, particularly with their AD sitedness that required CAS and mailbox to always be in the same site with hub there. The load balancing changes, moving away from RPC from the Outlook side and making Outlook an HTTP client. We wouldn't have been able to get this without doing that because we're largely relying on the failover within the HTTP client stack and in the DNS stack as well. From my perspective, that's the most important thing. All those collection of changes had to happen in the way they happened for this to occur. Had any one of them not happened, you'd be back to the 2010 model that you're in today. But because we were able to do all these things and do them not just together, but do them in the right way as well, we're now able to get all this brilliant new functionality that totally changes everything. Again, your RTO is just dropped to almost zero, to 20 seconds. You don't even probably have to declare that. I mean, you could just say RTO of zero and just say, yeah, it's really 20 seconds, but we measure in minutes, and I'm rounding down. Yes. What motivated us to drop MMC? The cloud, honestly. For customers deploying Exchange 2010 in the cloud or in a hybrid, you can't use MMC because it's RPC and WMI based. So they had the Exchange control panel, the web-based UI. And so what we did is we took largely almost all the functionality. In fact, I think there's literally one function that is missing that we had in MMC that is not in EAC, the Exchange Administration Center. Otherwise, everything is fully there. And the one thing is just an obscure thing related to the DAG, and I've actually put a lot of heat and pressure on the PM to try to get it in for RTM. So if I'm lucky, and he seems to think we'll get it, so we'll have at RTM, I'm hoping 100% parity between EMC and EAC. And of course, in a coexistence environment, which I'll talk about Friday, you're gonna have them both around. You'll still need the legacy one to manage legacy objects, and you'll need the new one to manage the new stuff. But it was largely, we needed an internet-friendly client, and Remote PowerShell is already one because it's all HTTP-based. But the MMC was not, because it was, like I said, RPC and WMI-based. So it was largely that needed it. It's also not very firewall-friendly either. So now we've done away with it, and we have a UI that, in my opinion, is not only cleaner and better looking, but it's so much faster than the MMC Snap-in was. It just loads, and it does things that are like boom, boom, boom. I mean, we're really actually super proud of how snappy, even when you're doing things like listing a large number of recipients or something like that. It's just so super fast. Yes? Is it still the control panel? Yes. So ECP is gone. Now there's just two management interfaces, the Exchange Administration Center, which is the web console, and the Exchange Management Shell, which is the remote PowerShell. So if a user is in Outlook Web App and they choose Options, they go into EAC. Sure. I mean, yeah, you could disable that. You'd still have to keep the ports open for users to be able to do things in EAC. There's a lot of stuff they need to do, like out of office, spell check, mail settings, phone wipes, all those kinds of things. So you don't want to turn that off, but if you don't want them to be able to have an administrator functions through it, if you don't want your admin to do it, yeah, you could block that a couple different ways if you wanted to. I don't know necessarily why you might want to, because kind of the whole purpose of a web console is so the admin doesn't have to get in their car and drive somewhere to fix something. And especially if it's something super quick where they can just, you know, pull up a web browser, make a quick change, and call it good. I mean, I think you'll probably find that more desirable than not. Okay, any other questions before we move on to the giveaway portion? Yes. There's no what support? Oh, ADFS? Oh, NFS. No. No, we require block level storage still for Exchange. Largely, the our storage support stance has largely not changed too much over Exchange 2010. We still have almost the same requirements. The only difference is I didn't talk about them in this session, and I'm not going to talk about them here, but we will have them in the documentation shortly. But there are some Windows 2012 storage features that we will be supporting for Exchange 2013. But again, I'm not going to mention what those are or what we're doing with that. So there will be some changes there, but largely it's pretty much what we had in 2010. Okay, let's give some stuff away. Wow, four cars. Oi. Now are these, because I didn't hand out two in the other one. Okay, oh boy. All righty then. Oh, and four keys too. I think each car is going to get a key, because what good is a car without a key, right? Okay, so I think to make things simple, I liked Lohit's idea of using the batch numbers. So I'm going to start by looking at where my badge is, and let's see who is closest to 1250. 1250. 1250. What do you got? 1433. 1393, closer. 1342, closer. 10,003? 1,003, too far. 1024, nope, too far. Nope, still in ahead. 204, nope. Yeah. 1340, yeah, so that puts him 90 away. Anybody closer than 90? All right, winner. Okay, I'm going to put this here for you.